Every day, you essentially pay your dues by doing the harder thing when it's the right thing to do.
So the benefits of positive, healthy sport for athletes are, of course, not having harmful sport experiences. Also, that there's increased enjoyment. And when people enjoy their sport experiences, they're more likely to stay involved, and not only stay involved as athletes, but stay involved post-retirement. And this is what we all want to see. People who love participating as athletes and stay in the sport in another role as a coach, as a volunteer, that they put their own kids in sport. This is the ideal picture. It also can lead to better performance, and this is an issue I'll come back to in a moment. And finally, that there are better relationships and the learning of important life skills. When you think about it, millions of parents around the country put their kids in sport for these very reasons, because it's a wonderful way to learn the important life lessons and life skills that are going to help them in school and in work and relationships outside of sport. This is why kids come into sport in the first place.
Sorry. What does the research kind of support that when we move in this matter of positive, healthy environments and supportive cultures, what do we get? Well, one is the coaches feel reduced stress and they feel reduced burnout rates, which I think unfortunately is something that a lot of people are dealing with right now. They also seem to enjoy their work better. They feel as though they have a purpose and a meaning behind going to work every day, working with the athletes, and they feel motivated and engaged to kind of be learning new things, trying new things, having healthy disagreement and healthy discussion. Not that it is always about money, but we have to be realistic that it is a financial endeavor to run a gym club. And so what we see is there is an increase financial health of the club. So there's more membership, there's more retention, there's more global income because kids are happier with their experiences. And so they stay in the program, whether that's the recreational level, they sign up for a continued semester, or the highest competitive team level. They stay involved as the difficulty goes up level to level. As Gretchen mentioned, we see an enhanced performance for the athletes, but also we see an enhanced performance for the coaches themselves. What we mean by that is that the coaches feel as though they are part of a professional partnership where there's success in terms of competitive performance, but also objective learning markers. And they also feel as though their own personal level of education is increasing to a sense of mastery, which is what the next point kind of alludes to, is they feel as though they are not just living to work. They feel as though they are really a part of something meaningful. They're making a big impact on the athletes' lives, and they themselves are increasing their personal skills, their personal education, and their ability to handle challenging problems. So a very important one towards the end here is that the coaches tend to have a better sense of self-esteem and self-worth. They feel as though they feel good about their self-worth in terms of feeling accomplished. They feel as though they're educated, and they feel as though when they solve problems, they feel good about that. And they also feel as though they have more self-efficacy, which goes along with that, which is the feeling that you have the resources to appropriately handle a challenge in front of you instead of getting frustrated. So very important list there, but I think it's important we kind of share the duality between athletes getting success, but also the coaches themselves being more successful with this model.
Here's what we know about what keeps people motivated and enjoying what they're doing. And when you have those two things happening, you're going to have increased performance. People need to feel that they have a choice and some say over what's happening to them and their experiences. They need to feel competent or a sense of mastery, that they're good at something in order to continue doing it. And because we're social beings, we need to feel like we belong. We need to feel connected to others. And so in relation to training, we need to have good relationships with our athletes and coaches and teammates in order to be motivated and enjoy and perform well. We need to feel like we're accomplishing something and achieving our goals. And we need to feel like we have some control over our experiences. Another way to look at it, and I'm sure many of you have seen this before, is a hierarchy of motivational needs. And starting at the bottom, of course, we need our basic needs met. And we can all relate to being exhausted or being very hungry and not being able to be very effective at our jobs because we're tired and hungry. We also need to feel safe, and that means both physical safety and psychological safety. So really hard to achieve when you're experiencing fear, for example. We need to feel included and feel that sense of belonging. And only when we have those needs met can we really strive to achieve performance-related goals. So by working with the lower levels and ensuring they're in place, we set the foundation for athletes and coaches to perform really, really well.
It was a situation where now I used to fear that if I said I don't know or I need help, that people would look at me, my athletes and the other coaches would look at me, would look down on me. And I was worried that I would feel some social pressure or shame associated with that. And so as is many things that happens in life, the things in your head are much worse than what actually happens in real life. And so when I started saying, a perfect example is this athlete was learning Yurchenko. She was twisting for the first time and I didn't really know exactly the drills I needed. And I was like, I actually don't know how to help you here. Let's keep doing layouts. And I'm going to talk to Nick. And I took a video and I just, after practice, reached out to Nick. I was like, hey, man, I actually don't think I'm the best here. Can you help me out? And in the moment, I was worried Nick was going to think I was a bad coach. But he instantly texted back and said, like, hey, no worries. Yep, like, I think it's common. A lot of people have this problem. So, like, try this. And the same thing started to happen with other areas, too, with strength conditioning, with the communication, the empathy thing I was talking about. The more I told people I didn't know, the more they respected me. And the more they actually realized I cared about them because I was willing to put my ego aside and say, I care more about you, your progress, your health, and your long-term development than my own self, self-inflation, so to speak. And so the biggest test that has actually happened is with the athletes now, is when things come up about not knowing skills or drills or technique or stuff like that, or answers to things, especially around areas I'm not an expert in, like nutrition or some other things. When I say I don't know, let me find someone to help you. It strengthens our relationship more than anything I've ever done in the past, along with, like I said, doing strength with the athletes. It strengthens the relationship more because they realize, like, wow, I think Dave really cares about me as a human, that he's willing to go out and seek outside resources. So when athletes see you studying and see you trying new things and learning from people, they really, I think, respect you more in the long term.
Absolutely. It might even be one of the best things to come out of this culture shift that we're all moving through, and that is alleviating some of the pressure on coaches to be the expert in every single aspect of a gymnast's life.
Yeah.
You know, they're trying to be the physio, the nutritionist, the conditioning and strength coach, et cetera, along with everything that's encompassed by being a really good technical gymnastics coach. It's really too much for anyone.
Yeah. It's funny because Nick and I have these conversations, and Eva actually too, who's a mental health kind of thing. And then my friend Christina, who's a very high level nutritionist. We have these conversations sometimes that, like, how much time and effort you save by just asking and learning for help from an expert is crazy, right? Because Nick sometimes texts me too. He's like, hey, I'm working with these athletes and they have ankle problems. I have no idea how to fix them. I could look it up and try to go online, but what do you think? And I'm like, oh, for me, I've spent 10 years helping people with these problems. I'm like, oh yeah, no problem. Try these three things. And the same thing with him on the Yurchenko. He's like, oh yeah, no problem. Try these four drills. I was like, oh yeah, that makes sense. So I think it's a situation where if you can realize that you're going to learn more, you're going to help the athlete, and it's going to feel good to learn something and kind of have that tool in your pocket in the long run. It's uncomfortable in the short term to learn, admit that, but in the long term, it's great. And I think we talked about in our discussion about how that little bit of uncomfortable feeling is necessary for progress. Wow. when you question someone's abilities and their way of thinking, you're many times their self-identity is attached to those methods and those beliefs. And so when you say someone has to change, you're actually threatening their identity as a coach. And I think a lot of times that's what's going on. And I've thought a lot about this now in my own life is, my sense of self-worth and my self-esteem was tied to my knowledge level as a technical gymnastics coach. So when someone tells me like that Gretchenko looks terrible, I'm really hurt by that because I'm like, I think I'm doing a good job, So I think you have to, which leads into my approach is I really believe that the cornerstone of approaching these things is empathy. I really do. I think you have to take the time to really stop and think about like, well, what is this? What's going through this person's mind that they're still using these methods that maybe science has moved away from or are concerning? And so I get a lot of DMs about this, about people who are trying to ask for help. And I say, hey, you have to start with empathy. You have to start with accountability and say, what's my role to play here? Is there something that I'm contributing to it? Because you take that to the conversation. But also you should research beforehand and say, what are three solutions that could happen here as an alternative? And that's how you approach the conversation. You say, hey, I understand maybe you feel this way about this certain technique or the way you do stuff. And I realize that maybe I haven't really been great. I got to fix these two or three things. But here's a problem that I'm noticing. A lot of other coaches notice it. And I'm trying to find a constructive solution because I think everybody will be happier, you included, if we can change this. So here are three things I've thought about. But in your mind, back to this question that I use a lot now is like, well, what is your ideal future that you would like to see come out of this? And that, coaches often say, well, like these athletes need to get these skills and they need to move up in levels. They need to perform better at meets. I need them to be stronger and faster. And then you pause and you go, okay, well, if what we were doing was working, we wouldn't be having a conversation and we wouldn't have a problem. They'd be fast enough. They'd be strong enough. They'd all be level 10s. They'd get their goals. No one would be hurt. But clearly it's not working because these girls say their back hurts and these girls haven't done well. And these guys over here are really complaining about burnout. So something is wrong and I'm trying to find an alternative solution to work together here and figure it out. What do you think is the best way to do that? And then you have a fluid conversation about, okay, I hear that. And you outline how the small goals of things you might want to change that you've researched are eventually going to lead to that bigger goal they want.
Sport has very strong military roots. It was established.
Touche.
And we have lots of leftovers from that, lining kids up, even our language, offense, defense, for team sports. There are lots of remnants of military practices in sport. Drills is another example. So, I guess just having that ability to reflect and say, every time there is that kind of military authoritarian reference, to a little light should go off and say, is there a better way? Is there a more democratic way to do this? And that would be my first thought about that.
Great. Any thoughts, Dave?
Yeah, there are times when we line up more out of necessity because we're worried about being in another group's like event rotation. But for the majority of times, we just have a group like casually get around us in a group, like literally a group. So we just chat that way. And as long as people are focusing and their eyes are kind of like, in my direction, and I have their attention, then I'm okay with that. I don't think I need to put them in height order. Sometimes we line up and it's just find a spot in the line because of necessity, not because of order. But I've always been fine with group kind of surrounding.